Good morning, everybody. I was just actually trying to pull up a last minute song to play in as our intro song, but I guess we won't do a song this morning. We'll just say hi. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the very first Instructional Designers in Offices Drinking Coffee, talking about responsive design. Hi, Chris.
Good morning, Brent. It's pretty early morning for you.
Yeah, it's not too bad. It's about 7 o'clock. Mountain time for anybody else that might be joining us or watching via the Facebook stream.
Yeah, what's the weather in Phoenix going to be today? A lot of clouds and heavy rain.
Yeah, beautiful with a little bit more beautiful with a touch of beautiful on the side. It's pretty much just how it is this time of year.
Yeah.
We did get rain yesterday though, which tends to throw people a little bit. Seeing like water falling from the sky is not something we see an awful lot.
Well, here in Eastern Ontario, we have a lovely winter day. It's going to flirt above the freezing mark today, and the sun is really, really strong. You can see that in my webcam, I think, behind me, that the sun is streaming through my office blinds here. For a winter day, it's actually going to be a really nice one today.
Really nice day. No, didn't have to have any parka on this morning.
Oh, well, you always have to have a parka on, even in the summer. I mean, that's just Canadian.
It's just part of being Canadian, right?
Yeah, that's default. The difference is
Does
that. Go ahead.
everybody in Canada have a toque? I've always been wanting to ask that.
I think most people do, yeah. I mean, it's the most practical way to keep your head warm.
That's standard gear, right?
Pretty much, yeah.
That's funny. My video keeps dropping out. This is going to drive me nuts, but I guess people don't really need to see me.
Well, we do
I'll drop
know.
it
Maybe just mention for
back.
anybody who's watching the recording of this, which we'll put out later, that the because we're using GoToMeeting today, the webcams don't record by default in GoToMeeting. So if you're watching the recording, you can't actually see us on the cameras. So, sorry about that.
Yeah, oops.
Yeah.
This is just a test, though. So, for I guess we should kind of start off with that. What the heck is this, and who are we, and why are we doing this? This is a start at adding some extra value to the Domino community, but the learning and development community at large. Giving back, talking about some of the hot topics of the day. We're going to be here every week. At this same time, once a week on Wednesdays for now. If it gets to be a really popular thing and for some reason this time doesn't work, we can always shift it, but we just kind of wanted to get started with this just to see where it goes, right, Chris?
Oh, for sure.
Yeah, so that's and so we'd love your feedback. If you are listening to this recording, or maybe you see something on Twitter about what we're doing here, and you're like, what? What are those crazy guys doing? What is instructional designers in offices drinking coffee? That sounds silly. Of course it is, because it's meant to be totally casual and just drinking coffee in the morning, starting your day, and talking shop, getting ready for your day ahead. And so that's why we're doing this. It's to support our community, the Domino community. And we have a LinkedIn group if you're a Domino user and want to get more engaged with it. If you are new to the Domino platform, you should absolutely reach out. Chris, where could somebody find you if they're all of a sudden thinking, oh, I can't listen to this whole thing, but I might want to reach out to Chris?
Sure. The you know what might be simplest for this purpose? Just info at domino.com. Because there's no way anybody's going to remember how to spell my name after, a session like this. So.
So, speaking of that, who the heck is Chris Van Wingerden? Did I say that
Well,
right?
yeah. Nice job on it. I actually had someone really he got to the van and that's all he could do yesterday. So yeah.
I
No.
tried to add even a Canadian accent too.
A? Well, we'll have you saying process in no time.
Yes, you will. I always forget about that.
Yeah, no, well, my official title here at Domino is Senior Vice President of Learning Solutions, which is, oh my gosh, even longer than my actual last name. I work a lot with the client teams, getting them getting client teams started, up and running in our platform, helping them with training. I meet a lot of them in the early part of the sales cycle too, just through demos and helping people assess and understand the product, that kind of thing too. So we're a fairly flat organization on the whole, and a lot of us do a lot of different things. But in the general bailiwick of what I do is help people get started and then keep going. So
awesome. And for those of you who don't know me, my name is Brent Schlenker. I actually just recently joined dominKnow and super happy to be here, helping to build out this user community. Oh yeah, and I forgot we had visual aids for everyone.
We thought that far through. Yeah.
We did, which is awesome. I'm not used to this. So I'm going to have to get used to knowing that this is coming up. So yeah, it's all good. But I'll be taking care of y'all here in Domino Land. And if you're, want to offer up any suggestions, if you'd like to hang out with us actually on a morning with Grant and Chris on Instructional Designers, you want to just have a cup of coffee ready and live stream in during one of these meetings, that would be awesome too. We would love to engage the community more and actually see those projects and the things that you're working on. But since we've decided to only keep this live stream to about 30 minutes, I'm going to stop with the formalities and jump right into what we did want to talk about today. Big topic in the L&D and the learning or e-learning development world is the idea of responsive design. What the heck is it? Why do we want to talk about that, Chris?
Well, it's certainly a buzzword. I think a lot of folks have heard the phrase. And certainly it's the normal thing now in the way that the world designs websites, but it's not something that I think a lot of people from our e-learning type world and training and development world, beyond having a vague idea of it, they don't know maybe exactly what it is and why it's different than working in maybe a standard e-learning type of a tool and some of the ripple effects of that. There's lots of really cool things that you can enable your content to do, but also lots of things that are different. So new opportunities, I think, to create things. But it all comes out of the fact that thinking about responsive design is a different thing than thinking about, I guess, what we would call traditional e-learning design.
Yeah, it's an interesting concept to me. I've known about it for a while and I've seen it and I understand it, but from a development perspective, didn't really start getting into seeing how you do have to think differently about your instructional design process, because with everything having that ability to be so fluid and move around on the screen, then that's might have a tendency to throw some people off because they're used to placing everything very, very meticulously in a specific spot and they expect it to stay there.
Yeah, for sure. And that's the sort of the leap of faith I sometimes think about with responsive design. So I've just turned the PowerPoint off and just showing a blank page here because it's probably a good place to start thinking about what responsive design isn't.
Great.
A responsive design, if you're thinking about working in PowerPoint, you have a page and that page has, fixed dimensions. And I'm going to be kind of spazzy, I know it, with my little highlight drawing here, but people will get the idea.
I love the pen.
It has a fixed height and a fixed width and, kind of like a photograph or a video, right? And when we put something on that page, oops, got to switch back to the pointer because apparently you can't point and highlight. If I want to just drop in, let's say, a hunk of text and I put that on the page, and of course I double check to make sure that I actually didn't make a typo, and let's make that a little bigger to be visible. All right, so maybe that's my title on the page. And now I'm gonna drop a picture. And I should have, let's put Brent and Chris on the page. There we go. Everything that we're adding on the page, it has a it's got a sense of depth. There's layers going on here. So the page has its height and its width, and then things that are on it have a specific location in the flat sort of two dimensions of the page, but it's also got a sense of three dimensions as well. If we go to the, oh my gosh, I can't believe I was just playing with this yesterday. Where do I go for that? Where's the slide, the viewer that shows us the layers?
In PowerPoint?
Yeah, I'm having a mind meltdown here. Oh my gosh.
I didn't even know you could see the actual layers.
Yeah. There's a spot where you can do that. And where is it? Oh my gosh. Wow. Okay. Having a having a minor meltdown here.
Don't worry, everybody. We're trained professionals.
Yeah, no kidding. At any rate, we know that it has that sense of depth because we can go to we can, you know, bring it something to the front or send it to the back. So there's a sense of layering on the page, right? And we think about e-learning content that we make. Well, a lot of the tools that, you know, traditional e-learning tools, even like our own Claro authoring mode, they work in this dimension that the page has a fixed size. And you put stuff on the page and you can put things over top of each other. So if I move the picture here, well, it's actually over top of, you know, the text. We have that sense of layers, that three dimensionality of the page. So there's, yeah, get technical, X and Y coordinates, but there's also like the Z of the depth of the page. And so we do a lot of things in e-learning. In e-learning, we put a button on the page and it shows something, and that something was often appearing over top of other things. And so we have this kind of, well, I call it a frame or a box, but it's also got this level of depth to it. Kind of like maybe, you know what, like the, when take us back to kindergarten, the felt board where the you have the characters in the background and, you know, different layers of, you know, cutout characters on top of each other and stuff like that. That same idea that you've got a little bit of that third dimension kind of going on. So that's PowerPoint. And basically the same sort of model of typical e-learning kind of content. And it's the way that the traditional e-learning, the traditional web design went. We, for the longest time, we built pages, the web pages that were 800 by 600. And then we got little bigger monitors and they were 1024 by 768. And we all went, ooh, cool, we could make some little bigger pages. And then when first mobile devices came out, we made a second version of our site with a, you know, a much smaller set of pages physically. But what happened was we then got tablets, and tablets meant that they're not, now what do we do? Have another third version of the website for that medium size of screen or whatever. Anyway, the technical answer to all of that became, let's, nice highlighting. I think I'll erase that.
Yeah.
You know, the technical answer was something completely, a completely different way of making content called responsive design. So I'm going to pop that up. So when we're first talking, when I'm first talking to a lot of folks, they go, oh yeah, responsive. We want our content to fit on, you know, all the devices, which is, you know, kind of the core idea, but more than fit, it's about making an ideal or a more ideal experience than across different screen sizes versus, excuse me, pardon me, just making something fit, you know, making it squish in to a certain degree. The core thing that responsive design is different at is that it is, the pages are structured differently. They don't have the same sense of depth. They're built as what we call a fluid grid. Actually, let me just pull something else up here.
And I'm sure people are very used to seeing that grid type structure on web pages these days because it's extremely common. I mean, not everybody has shifted over to it yet, but that sort of grid format of content is a direction that, especially portal style websites are going to, right?
Well, just about any commercial website these days has gone to responsive. And that's just because of the sheer ways that people, you know, look at different content. You might be.
Let's look at that browser, that Boston browser again.
Yep.
The Boston Globe one.
Go ahead.
Yeah, I was just going to say, so squish that down and show people what it's like, and let's just jump right in and just make sure we get people that visual of what we're talking about.
Yeah, so as I get skinnier, you can see, like, if you just watch the text, it's not staying the same width. As the columns get smaller, it's then flowing downward to fill the space differently. And in a heartbeat, right now we've got these three columns of content. And then at the top, there's a header area there, the masthead,
yeah,
typically from a newspaper perspective. And we get a little skinnier. Well, we just changed to two columns. Mm-hmm. So there's like a little wee 2-pixel spot. There we go. We currently have three columns of things, and now we have just two columns. But the other stuff is still here. We scroll down, I can still see the ad. And here's the other, you know, the content that was in the third column. It's just been moved down. And we can take that even skinnier. And notice the masthead has changed. So we used to see the whole Boston Globe with the full menu.
And oh, yeah, that's
skinnier.
I wasn't even looking up there.
They're doing a little logo and just the classic sort of hamburger menu there. And get a little skinnier, and we're going to actually, it'll flip to being, there we go, single column, more or less, with some variations in it for visuals.
It's great how they do the variations like that. It's not like every single bit of content adjusts to look exactly the same. And they keep it, you know, everything adjusts and becomes something different when you get down to that really small level, but they're able to do it in a different way.
Yeah.
Bigger pictures at the top and then the smaller little thumbnails at the bottom.
Yeah. And, you know, one of the things with mobile devices is that we live in a world where scrolling is just much more acceptable. And, you know, if you're watching your Twitter stream or even your Facebook stream, you're scrolling, right? So that old sense of, oh no, everything's, you know, scrolling is bad, has changed. It's just become another access route to get to something or to navigate something, as opposed to being seen as a barrier or a problem. There's a couple of others here here's a Sony site. You can see that really strong sense of a grid with all these pictures. I mean, obviously, because they're kind of shaped that way. And then as we get skinnier, boom, things have readjusted themselves.
Yeah.
And one more here. This is, you can see those things getting smaller. Now,
someone's going to ask me this at some point. Sorry to interrupt, but I'm going to drop in just an instructional design thought real quick and just ask the question that I know I'm going to get, and that is, has anybody done any research or anything about the impact on the instructional effectiveness of this content is shifting around and, you know, by being able to do this, does it have a positive or negative impact on what it is I'm trying to develop and what I'm trying to create as a designer?
So I'm not aware of any specific studies. There have been lots of studies on, you know, from a marketing perspective, how people use different screens and devices, you know, as a pattern of usage during the day. And that from a marketing perspective, there's a sense that the thing that you did a quick search, the site that you did a quick search on for something on your phone, when you're going to spend a little bit more time, if you're at a, you know, on a bigger screen later, when you're actually going to maybe do a bit more reading or whatever, or research on that product, well, it should be the exact same site. People shouldn't have a sense that they're seeing something different from one to the next. And so that's, you know, sort of the problem that responsive design solves from that perspective, plus the fact that you're making one site and you only have to make changes once. You don't have to make changes to multiple versions for different sizes of screens. It's a really important, you know, aspect of all of this as well. But back to the effectiveness of this as a learning opportunity. Well, these three examples are all, you used the word portal a minute ago, but these are all sort of, you know, home pages where you pick something and then you sort of dig deeper into it to get more information about that one particular thing. Mm. Whereas e-learning tends to be more like a PowerPoint, right? You're just using pages to convey one sort of core topic often, or to navigate, you know, an experience. So, you know, not all e-learning necessarily needs to be responsive, but it's definitely a plus if you want to make it as open and easily consumable as possible. You know, this is almost an e-learning page where you have, you know, sort of a title, a picture on the left and text on the right, and that kind of a layout.
Yeah, so. Yeah, and just being able to change, I think what responsive design allows us to do is get a little bit closer to that ideal of I'm taking some content on my desk at work and I'm not done with it, but I need to leave and go do something. If I want to go and look at that content again, but on my mobile device, you can, and that content then shifts based on my experience, like what I'm currently viewing it from. And before, we never really had that ability. I mean, we had that ability, but it wouldn't adjust effectively to the different device or the size of the new screen that you were viewing it on, right? That was sort of phase one of this transition to mobile, where we took that fixed idea of content and we just were able to make it play as is on a mobile device. But then everything shrunk down and was too small and you couldn't read it and all the things that people were frustrated with. Now we have this ability to make the content, I guess, smart, if you will, and know that if you're on a smaller device, that it knows to adjust its images, to stack things differently, to make the columns differently, if that's how you design it. And then, so I think the reason why I ask this from an instructional design perspective is knowing where to, you know, add that extra value. So, you know, the authoring tools give the instructional designer the ability, or the developer, to make those decisions and say, hey, you know what, when the screen is smaller, they're able to say, what, let's bump up the text to X size, or at what width of that particular column, like how far does it have to be squished down before it shifts into a single column, other, you know, than two columns, to make it easier to read and all of that. And I think those are things that I really haven't heard too many in the instructional design space address from a visual perspective. I mean, I'm certain people are talking about it, but it's going to be a much bigger concept, because that's something that I don't think a lot of developers are thinking about. Have you seen differently?
Well, we hear from folks who want to move in this direction, and a lot of the drive often for that is that it's as much about providing opportunities for learning outside of something that we call a traditional e-learning course. So, you know, you make your e-learning course, you publish it as SCORM, it goes in the LMS and people take it because it's the annual certification program or something that they have to do. But, or even if you made a curriculum for people to, you know, onboard through it to a new role, and they've taken all those courses in the LMS and they've passed the test, well, they've got to start doing their actual work at some point. And so being able to have content that can be applied to both that formal learning process and then that same content being used outside of the LMS, maybe as a, in a web app or something that you create, where you've now got a place where people can look up stuff when they need it. They, you know, oh man, I need to do that task now. It's been 3 months. I vaguely remember it. So, you know, rather than going back to the LMS, let's give them content outside of that. And in that model, they're going to grab whatever's the closest thing that they've got. You know, if they're trying to do steps in a task, it might actually be easier to pull that up on their phone while they're working on their computer for the actual task, the learning material on their phone. So from my perspective, the opportunities of responsive design really help us move to more of a stronger level of support anyway for the whole 70-20-10 kind of a model, or performance support type content. Getting out of just, you know, limiting our thinking to only, oh, they took a course in the LMS and now they know everything. So So that's the, you know,
yeah,
the flexibility.
I guess that is the real kicker, because everybody does talk about that. Hey, you know, how can we do more than just courses? And then the question shifts to how can we utilize what we are using in the course in other areas? And that's kind of the direction that the new tools are going and what we need to be supporting. That idea of all content is useful, but making sure that it's available, easy to get to, in the right format, just the right time. You mentioned 70-20-10, all of that kind of stuff, how important it is, and people are trying to figure out, okay, this is great, we understand it, now how do we do it?
Yeah. And I mean, just to circle back to the, you know, why is responsive design so different? Well, in order for that content to change, there's this idea of a fluid grid. So your pages are more like building almost in a table kind of a structure. And I like this little tile puzzle metaphor, because the content kind of basically is all in a, it's in a frame, and everything's all in the same kind of layer, and it slides around itself to adjust the page. And that's a different line of thinking than making something that has a specific, you know, page height and size, and that idea of layers on a page, because you use different techniques to do similar things, but you don't have the same sense of layering that we would typically take advantage of in a traditional e-learning course in that way. Well, you know, one of the things that you start to see even in the web design world is that there's sort of been a reduction in the whole notion, necessarily anyway, of you know, that you've created a wireframe completely in Photoshop first, because Photoshop is, you know, like PowerPoint, it's fixed pixels, stuff goes where it goes. So you start to see a movement in the web design world of people actually starting to design a little bit more in process and starting to make things actually happen, etc. So a little bit of a, you know, a design process change that goes along with some of these new ideas too.
Yeah, you know, we've only got a few minutes left before we've told ourselves we're going to keep this to 30 minutes every week. And we didn't get a chance to get into Domino too much, but maybe what we could do is just quickly to wrap up. What is it that, is there a big aha moment when you demo this for people, or when, you know, you introduce this or new customers get onboarded? What is the thing that, you know, if there is one thing that really seems to stand out for people, you know, there's so much too. I mean, there's so many.
Yeah, there's a lot to think about. There's that process of simply learning a tool. Well, where are all the buttons to do all the things that I want to do? But there's also that mind shift. But I think when you're actually authoring in our flow authoring mode, and you're able to, you know, take the stage and watch it change and the behaviors on it as you're making it, that's kind of goosebumpy. To be honest, it's kind of like a, ooh, that's cool. You know, I can do that. Yeah. And it's not hard the way that we've set flow up. So it's that kind of a sense that that people have, that like, ooh.
In the design, you know, mode, you can just now, yeah. you can squish it, add more text. If all of a sudden you realize, oh, there's a lot more text I need to add, you drop it in, and then you can immediately shift the size of the screen and see how it's going to respond and react. And then you can adjust accordingly, right?
Yeah, and it's you know, the range of things that we can do, from simply having content, you know, go from being horizontal to being vertical to actually showing and hiding other content. That's a really neat for those who like to think design wise. That's a real fun thing to sort of roll up your sleeves and get into and start thinking about all the variations of things that you could have that page doing.
There are some other places where people can go to find this stuff, right? Like, what if somebody doesn't want to wait until next Wednesday to hang out with us? You know, where can they go to it, just get, you know, to watch you walk through it? You've got some recordings, right? Do we share those out on a site somewhere of you walking through it? Or maybe some of the other Wednesday, the other Wednesday recordings that you do, maybe?
Yep, we can. Probably if someone wanted something to get started, let's use that info@dominKnow.com email again.
Okay.
Then we could share some links out to some other sessions and stuff a little bit more in depth.
But you've got one coming up today, don't you?
Yep, we do have we call it our weekly webinar. It's you know, be frank, it's pretty marketing oriented, but it's a good glimpse into this and a lot of other sort of core values in the platform. So we do have some other things too. Our YouTube channel, youtube.com/dominKnow. There's some pieces in there that help, you know, help. We hope anyway, help people, you know, start to get a glimpse of how some of this stuff is different than working in a more traditional e-learning mode. So a couple of different places.
Yeah, anyway. All sorts of places to find it. So, well, this has been fun this morning for 30 minutes, just hanging out, having a cup of coffee. Maybe we should make this a little bit more regular activity. It's a great way to start the day, don't you think?
I think it's pretty good. As long as the coffee's good, we're all good to go. So.
Yeah, right. And warm. It needs to be warm. Mine tends to cool off pretty quickly, so I'm going to have to get like a hot plate or something.
Get your hot plate with your percolator just bubbling away all session.
Yeah, just keep let it just, up. You know, I don't know, IV drip of caffeine in the morning, maybe that would work better. I don't know. But, yeah, you know, I'm sorry, folks. For some reason, I couldn't get the Facebook stream to work. I was like, I got half of the clicks done. And so if you were expecting to go to Facebook and check out the live stream, I'm sorry that wasn't there. You know, we're learning as we go here, as we try to create this. So, you know, don't expect miracles from us just yet. But those come later on, where this is just the teaser. So... if you want to hang out with us, this is something we're going to definitely be doing. For now, at least what we've decided is every Wednesday, 9 a.m. Eastern time, right? That's what we're looking at?
Yep.
Cool. So, yeah, so I think with that, we can say goodbye to everybody and tell them, hey, have a great day, and we will we'll see you next Wednesday. But you could also drop into that LinkedIn group if you have any questions as well.
Yeah, and watch our social media channels for the link for next Wednesday's session. It'll be a new link, but same.
Yeah,
same
that's right. Don't forget to follow all that stuff. The Twitter handle is just Domino, right? DOMINKNOW.
Yep. At yeah. Domino.
I think some people send me emails and they'll spell it out and they leave the middle N out.
Yeah, it's it's one of those things. It's a great wordplay when you see it visually, but then you try to spell it and everybody wants to just spell it wrong.
Yeah, so. Yeah. You gotta remember that the only letter that's actually dropped off is the O. So and then added back in again, of course. Mm-hmm. But anyways, okay, I'm just rambling again. That means I need more coffee. So can probably hit that stop recording button and say thanks to everybody for hanging out with us today. We'll see you next week.
Yeah, thanks, everybody. Talk to you soon. Bye.